Just take a look, if you can, at the Eucharistic Rites. You recall what's been online have been three forms of the Eucharist. What was called the standard, the common, and the ancient. The common, as if you had used it, you will have recognized, was largely an abbreviation of standard. One of the aims, as I said at the beginning, and Jim Packer has been, his dream was that we only have one Eucharistic text. The experience of the American 79 book was such, and of the liturgical renewal, there was just no way to simply have what was essentially the Anglican standard text. We really had to have an Apollo text, like prayers A, B, and D in the 79 book. But what the committee came to was a recognition that we could probably have two texts, not three. Since the common, so-called common text, which was an abbreviated form of the standard text, was an abbreviation, you could probably print the standard form in a way that showed you how you could abbreviate and not have to print the other text. So that the way in which it was printed would be the same in both the full form and in an abbreviated form. But we needed a clue about how to do it. And again, online, we usually would just provide, okay, here's how, if you wanted to do an abbreviated Anglican standard, here's what it would look like. But again, understanding the yearning of the church to have as few texts as possible for worship so that the texts go deep in people. And it's a different understanding of how worship works in the Anglican heritage than it is in either the Roman or most of the Protestant churches. Well, the Anglican standard text, and again, again, to help people to say, okay, so here's the standard. Well, okay, this is the 1662 text, which both our fundamental declarations and the universal declaration say is the standard for worship and doctrine in the church. So, frankly, I'm going to consider this is essentially a Reformation canon with developments, but it is what the English Reformation used as its way of making the universe. It's essentially that the Holy Communion service, the Book of Common Prayer, 1662, and successive books through 1928, 1929, and 1962. 28 U.S., 29, 62 Canada. The Anglican Standard Text is presented in contemporary English, and in the order of the Holy Communion, it is common since the late 20th century among ecumenical and Anglican partners worldwide. Okay? So it's presented not in 1662 order. It's presented in the order that most of who were raised in the Episcopal Church and knew the 1928 article is presented in virtually the same order as the 28 order, also presented in the same order as in the 1962 Canada and the 1928 of the Reformed History of the Church. But that order is not the same as the historic order. The Anglican Standard Text may be conformed to its original content and ordering, as in the 1662. Okay? That's a huge statement. And in the additional directions, which appear in the materials, after the review of text, you'll see that what the order in 1662 is. As in the 1662 amendments, Mr. Bright read four subsequent books. Okay. What you're being given permission to do here is you're being given permission to use the order of 1662 or the order in which Holy Communion is run in any of the books up until the present book. Why does this matter? Some people recall that in all of the books until 1979, the Creed, the Nicene Creed, and the sermon were reversed. From 1549 on, the pattern was to have the gospel, the creed, and then the sermon. Okay? And for some people, that order still matters. So give them permission. Okay. You can do that. That's okay. What's really good is that they've been formed as Anglicans, right? Okay, they really know the word, and they don't need the words of them. They can say it with you. Most parishes and bishops might be a little, but in that Kimberly place, he's going to pop the role with it, right, Bishop? Again, I hope all of us give you more and more appreciation of what Bishop does by going from place to place and kind of working on all this. The initial directions give clear guidance on how this would be accomplished, right? The 1662 order. This was particularly important for the evangelicals in Canada. This was a major issue. If 1662 is the standard, how come we can't use the 1662 book? Well, the way in which we came at this is that you can imagine all of this herding cats and negotiation. Bishop John Guernsey and Bishop Charlie Masters and I spent 2 days in Victoria, in Vancouver, last Easter Monday and Tuesday, working with us with the Canadians. To again find a way that would help them to be part of this whole church in words that the whole church was using together in a prayer book that the whole church could embrace that they could use and use in the 1662 order. That's what they chose to do. Similarly, there are directions given as to how to hang the standard text, maybe abbreviate where appropriate for mission ministry. This is the provision, and I'll show you where it shows up when we look at the text. This is the provision that allows the abbreviating of the Anglican Standard Text in a way that feels very much like those of you who are using the common text. In terms of the number of words, it's a shorter word, but it's in the English Reformation language as opposed to the patristic Catholic language. The two basic ways that the universal stuff has been done. Just looking for a moment into this, again, this multicolored, which has the Anglican standard in it. The only affirmation is given up front again for folks who may be far into this is just the basic blessing of God, both the Easter affirmation and the affirmation, and any seasonal reading, they're all in the material after the Eucharistic stuff. The color for purity in all of the rites, and there are elements of Anglican piety. That as a college bishop has looked at this, we just say, this is how Anglicans pray and how we think. And so the color for purity, which was optional 1979, Bishop Hoffman has in both rites. There it is. And in both rites, the summary of the law is required, or the biblical law. The Kyrie is set up, again, it's across the page, parallel fashion, including the provision for the Greek to be said, the only part of the liturgy that remains in Greek. Again, because liturgy has point in the people, the reality is it's very hard to change once it's ingrained and embedded in the third century, second, first century, when Latin supplanted Greek, and the Kyrie eleison, the only person you could call Kyrie was the emperor. And they were pretty proud saying Kyrie, referring to Jesus, that came rather than Caesar. And so they just wouldn't give it up. And it remains in the liturgy 20 centuries later. It's similar to what happened with the Psalter we mentioned covered before. And you would have thought in 1662 that the King James Version of the Bible would have been the standard form of scriptural text. You know, at that point, I mean, great claim of the Authorized Version. Problem is that the words of the Psalter, the church said, no, thank you. We know our cover and we're not going to use 1611 King James, thank you very much. We're using 1539. We had to learn in the Esper School proposed to the college bishops that when the 23rd Psalm was printed, which is the only Psalm that is really in among the people in the King James Version, that it is printed alongside of the cover of the 23rd, by of course, the Psalter. So, again, you know, just like we did two forms of the Lord's Prayer, it's deeper than people's devotion and economy. It's clear enough there's no reason to discount it if it's gone that deep. Important changes. The college bishops used this rite, the first rite when it was together in January of this year. And the first rite finally got to, and we believe in my Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God. It's, you know, since the ICD text is only the only Son of God. The problem is, when you pass a resolution as the College of Bishops that will translate the Creed as near to the Greek as possible, which is why you get a phrase like, that became incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, that's what the Greek says. When it says the angel, it is actually, it's not just only, it's only begotten. So the third begotten is back. your people will get over that very quickly. And the issue there is not that we were changed for change sake, but there's no question that the Nicene Fathers, when they said only Son, really meant the only begotten Son. That's what they meant. So that's what he said. Again, there were some of the issues in the International Constellation of English Texts in the 1970s was to try to back off some from the difficult things that the Creed says. So you get became incarnate by the power of the Holy Spirit. Well, that isn't in the Greek. It isn't what the Father said. He became incarnate of the Holy Spirit and Virgin Mary. That's what it says. That's what the church embraced. And so it might be nice to try to explain it, but that's actually not the purpose. Again, I think you see as you, and I know you all struggle with this in different ways, we, in the midst of a season of real theological drift, as the church came to say, so we're going to take the Word of God, the whole of it, and we're going to read it, and we're going to consider it, and we're going to take the texts that are given and you have the continuing issue of having the stone for the oakway in the Nicene Creed. The issue for Anglicans is that the 39 Articles actually teach a double procession. They teach that the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. So if the 39 Articles are among your fundamental declarations, you're kind of caught in the Western edition of and the Son. Though, again, for ecumenical purposes, it's been the way the Catholic Church deals with this is great stuff. When the ecumenical patriarch and the Bishop of Rome are together, they see the creed in Greek. It solves the problem. That's been true since Paul VI. Okay? We can solve the problem too if we said it's pretty big, but that probably creates another problem for the Anglicans. Because Anglicans, another one of the articles said that everything will be in a language understood in the people. Right? So there you go. But when people ask why are people holding that? They probably won't be as much of a basis as deep enough in the psyche that once it's there, it's there. For anybody who's had any kind of history in the life of the church. One of the things that happens in the Eucharistic liturgies is to give permission for any of the prayers of the people in any of the rites to be interchanged. So there's that thing which didn't exist in the 13 texts. There's also an outline for prayer as well as in the Sunday night book that gives permission for, in any of these rites, for the local congregation to write its prayers to the people as long as they include prayers for the whole church, prayers for the authority, prayers for the mission of the church, prayers for the bishops and clergy, prayers for the peace of the world, and so on, prayers and remembrance of the faithful party. The college bishops really worked very hard a few years back. I was still a bishop at trying to figure out how to deal with the Nicene Creed and how to deal with both we are ecumenical partners in the East, they're across from us if we have and the Son. And yet the Anglican and the Western tradition work literally what the article says about the filial prayer. Is that it's useful for the explication of doctrine and it's normal in the worship of the church. We just pray it in the same way. It's the best we can do related to our Eastern partners. We've got to say, in the West, this is part of the way the West has understood this. And it's not that this is optional for us, given the role of the 39 Articles have in our life. This is the 39 Articles teach this, so we can't just eliminate it unless it would be convenient. What I say, given that we're holding the Catholics, the charismatics and the evangelicals together, and also holding the musicians together, maybe the prayer book 2049 can deal with the Latin titles. But probably the things are known, and particularly how they're known musically. Holy, what would that refer to? Sanctus, you know, you're talking about that place in the liturgy, that this may be as easy as possible, but whether it will endure forever. I don't know. I think that the texts are helpful. Again, another place where that really exists is in Psalter. Judica May, I mean, Psalm 42, Psalm 43, what do we still need the Latin in Chibet? for the song. But that's often how they're identified among musicians. Let's see, Lang and Sue. Or the fraction. You could send in that question. That is in Don Gregory Dixon's, really very seminal work in the late 19th century, The Shape of the Liturgy. The what he argues what the whole the Christian world accepted was he took offertory, he blessed consecration, he broke fraction, and he gave communion. We'll go ahead and say once you understand what you said, not because I know most about clergy, but because I heard cats, and I love to keep Catholic cats in the same stable with evangelical cats, so sometimes they fight. And the fraction would be what the Catholic cats would go for, even though these texts are wonderfully final, if you said it in, I know the liturgy committee will look at it and may think it's important to say yes, the bishop's now. The bishop signed off on it in this one. Again, it was much debated in bringing to this the historic person people have no permission for Thanksgiving. The assumption is that Thanksgiving is actually the great Thanksgiving, and the prayers of the people are petitions and intercessions, not Thanksgiving. But I think one of the very gifts of the St. John Carmel was to elicit the Thanksgivings of the people. It might be revisited still. Again, I say what you just said, the word in Liturgy Task Force at anglicanchurch.net. It'll be looked at and considered. It was certainly not given to anybody about how to deal with this. But it's now at least made it into the rubrics. Again, the historic rubrics didn't have that provision. And you should see the debates over how we deal with prayers for the dead, which are part of the covenant between the Scottish Episcopal Church and the American Episcopal Church. Three things were agreed, and one of those three things was that there'd be the prayers that we would pray for death, which is why in the 1789 book, it comes in an Anglicanism from a Scottish book of 1637, it was not there before, because prayers for the dead were eliminated at the Reformation. But by the time you get to something like Lancet Andrews, in the Caroline period, in his great prayer, the Dial, around with that moon mouth of solstice at midnight, the bridegroom shall come, wait the cry, the bridegroom come, the face out evermore in our ears, and we be never forgetful of the souls for whom he died, for whom we watch and pray. And so by the 17th century, it's become part of the debate, and it enters into the Scottish book and the American book, but it was never in the Canadian book or in the English book. Again, trying to figure out the way it's been fudged is, and let us pray for so-and-so who has died in Thanksgiving. The Catholics can read that, but we're praying for so-and-so, and we're thankful for it. And the evangelicals can read that, we're giving thanks for so-and-so. How do you bring a church together? Which has, again, in essentials, remember the wonderful, in essentials, unity. In non-essentials liberating in all things charity. So again, I think it's one of that's what we're trying to find a way in this that as best as possible can serve all church. And we've said from the start, we will not abandon this one. We want it to be attractive enough that people will want to use it. That all things considered, this is a good way. This is a faithful way for Anglicans in the 21st century to be formed and to form others. In terms of the, again, carrying us through on page 6, in the most classic kind of Anglican pattern of prayer, it does give permission for additional prayers for that, which would, of course, also, while it doesn't say Thanksgiving here, you certainly have the freedom to invite, I think, them. In the confession, it was agreed that the rhythm of the confession, the burden of that is one we can bear. Have mercy upon us. Again, those who have been read school in the tradition have that double, have mercy. And so, and some of us still beat our chest in these days. There it is. So again, these are things. If you consider the continuity, clarity still makes sense. Poetry ends on this one. Have mercy upon us. It's that the rhythm. And again, this came from several sources, and we have to see, can we restore that? When we pray this, we stumble here because we're used to saying this. The comfortable words in this and in the other service, they're printed in both services, they are optional. Again, they're printed in both services, and that is to say, primer. We thought if there were 4 verses of scripture, people wouldn't know. The reversing of these 4 verses was a pretty healthy thing for them. The offertory, again, I'm not sure that the rubric there is exactly the way it needs to be. The simple teaching is if you have some kind of doxology. Particularly if you're in a sung service, there would be no reason to say devotional files. This is a way in a said service to have a doxological. And this first appeared in the 1892 prayer book. This in the U.S. And it's very short because again, the people in so many circumstances in would at least have all things come from the Lord, and I don't have a gift. So it's just a recognition that this has become part of people's identity. And it's in liturgy, we're not meant to act one thing on top of the other thing on top of the other thing. So having that offertory in the doxology and saying the first and chronicles, that's a kind of doxological overkill. One or perhaps two, but not all three. There is, in terms of our people's present abilities, there's about a 75-minute limit on what will work on Sunday morning. The response in the search for a few things to say there. Again, lift up your hearts and come up to the Lord. The first time, the second time to do it, and therefore they don't all, if they can, it's just, well, we lift, as Steve Moses, we lift up. So the monk is back on the next page. What is the substantial change? And again, this is just a recognition that it is just and right, so to do, just didn't make sense. It was metrically right. It is being right, so to do. Again, so much of the music is set. It flows from just and right, so to do. But what is just mean in this context? The Roman Church, in its use of the Scripture Quran, just says it's just and right, which is doesn't help. Again, the music doesn't help at all. What the bishops debated, they went back to, on the recommendation of the liturgy task force and the bishops of the panel, was let's use the word that was developed in the ICET text, and that it was in the 79 curve, which metrically is right, and which makes sense to the mind. It is right in thanks and praise. And then the way in which the just idea was captured was to take from the again, from common worship, from the English prayer book, the way they dealt with this was to leave it is right to give thanks and praise, which is, again, not a good translation of the historical thing, but metrically works and works for the sense of our people. It is right, our duty and our joy. The just part, it is right and it is our duty. And that's the sense in which meet, when we used to say it is meet right, it's a duty and our joy. So that's been borrowed from the English opening of the preface to carry that idea which was lost from the last response in the Church of Corinth. That's right, you get some sense of how the church and struggles to find, again, this a common language that works for the whole church in its worship. If you look at the prayer of consecration, and I'm coming in to go to 9 o'clock, and I know we've got this a long night, but I hope it's important. If you look at what's been in the prayer of consecration, the therefore, Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of the Divine Son, I take Jesus Christ, your holy servant, celebrate me here before your divine majesty with these holy gifts. I'm trying to figure out why this is important. Let me just deal with the footnotes. The first paragraph, while praise and glory is yours, O Lord, Heavenly Father, that is the first paragraph of 1662. The second paragraph, and now, O Lord, this is the Ecclesis, which footnote 2 says, this paragraph does not occur in the 1662 Book of Common Prayer, but our dialogues, particularly with the Catholics, the East, and with the Lutherans, really expects that we'll ask the Holy Spirit to bless and sanctify. So it's included in the Spangled and Standard Rite, because that's the ecumenical consensus at this point, and our liturgies would be considered effective if the principle, if the standard didn't happen, even though the 1662 didn't happen. And permission is given to not use it if you're using 1662 during 1662. I mean, if you were going to use the African liturgy, you'd use the African liturgy with bishop's permission. But of course, the Kenyan liturgy would be under the canonical provision that prayer books previously used could continue to be. Use it. The falling night, and likewise after supper, you know the footnote there that says number three, this is the point at which the Eucharistic prayer ended in 1662. Very brief prayer. National communion was distributed. Right then and there. And then the rest of the prayer was actually prayed as a post-communion prayer. That's where the inflation what you'll see if you look at page 9 with the paragraphs with the bar in the margin, that's to say, and you look at additional directions, you'll see those are paragraphs that can be deleted. They're not essential to the Eucharistic prayer. Moreover, if you look at the preceding paragraph, first paragraph, you therefore order Heavenly Father, it says, you know, the end is remembering his blessed passion, precious death, his mighty resurrection, glorious ascension, his promise to come again. That, the additional direction said, can be, that's the anamnesis. And the memorial activation that was in the common Eucharistic text can actually be used. So that whole paragraph could be replaced by, therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, but it's the first of Christ to come again. It has the same effect as that paragraph. So if you were to take what's said in additional directions and substitute the memorial activation there, and then delete the two paragraphs that have lines, you would get a prayer. It was almost in like the common. It's not the same as the common, because the common began in a different way. But again, we're seeking to have the words of our services across different ways. So the folks going from place to place, even if you were using an abbreviated way, say, oh, this is the prayer of the prayer, so it's just shorter. It's not the habit of diversity of ways of praying, because that's actually not been the Anglican way. The Anglican way is to say, here's how we pray together. And we all have this on which, and that's what produces the greatest unity among us. And again, as long as the prayer is also theological. Next, probably the words of administration are interchangeable between the rites, and the words of administration are much simplified. In this rite, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, along with the rest of what was in 1559, the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, where you could stop there, or maybe use the words of distribution that are in the reagent text. These are interchangeable. Let's look for a minute at the reagent text. Again, all the things that I've said, the things that are highlighted that we already talked about on pages 1, 2, 3, 4. And again, on 4, you see the rubric that says you can use one of these phrases, or one, you can take prayers of people from any one of the services, including from the outline. You'll see at the top of 5 this provision, specific provision of thanksgiving is made in habit. So that, again, it acknowledges in the life of the church now the importance of that matter. It doesn't take a form before, but maybe you need to. Again, it's just recorded, you can see the changes that are there. When you get to the prayer of consecration, one of the pieces of feedback that became repeatedly was that prayer A of the 1979 prayer book was so deeply embedded in the spiritual audience, so many people, that if we were going to have a talk and style prayer, we needed not to have what we had offered before as the ancient, which was nearer to Hippolytus in some of those phrases, but simply to take a few of those phrases, which people really have become attached to and work them into prayer writing. So this is essentially prayer writing. This is just saying, in terms of disturbing the mind of the people, this was significant enough and deeply ingrained enough that this needs to be the basis of the prayer that we use. And that's why the change was made. So this is all high-rated because it's a different text than the one that was in the 2013. The ancient text wasn't in 2013. The ancient text was put up online subsequent to the printing of the Text of Common Prayer 2. Interestingly enough, this prayer and the way it was created in 79 puts the thesis after the words of institution, which drives the Orthodox and Catholics nuts. But as one notable bishop said, so what word is apologist putting in? This order. It's kind of like, so what is the job of this actually prayer? If you're going to call it, you probably, again, the Anglicans have had a view of when Christ is going to be present in the sacrament, just to declare that he is. The Roman concern about this, and to some extent the Greek concern, is actually not. When you said the words of institution, it is what he says it is, but Anglicans haven't taken that view as to how it happens. So we still have preserved the sense in which, it's the whole of the prayer that, he said, this is my body, this is my blood, this is how we take it. We don't describe how it happens or the moment in which it happens. One other thing about if you look at the prayer of humble access, you will see that, and it should be highlighted here, I think it was highlighted in the upper right. One of our discoveries was that there's probably no prayer that is more deeply in the consciousness of Anglicans than this prayer. Where it happens in the Eucharist, but this had more feedback than almost any other thing. You remember that as the writers like to say, we got rid of the motorcycle part, the manifold. As well, people want to think manifold in kind of that automotive sense. You're abundant in great verses. Again, manifold, abundant. That's clearer to the 21st century. There was a fair amount of feedback, theological feedback, about who always delights in showing mercy, which was a much appreciated line. But as the theological folks pointed, this is an Aristotelian prayer. And to give God anthropomorphic characteristics to his delights is something that happens in the Old Testament, but really it's either his property or his character is always in immersion. So whereas property, like the word manifold, property works even less well than manifold. Again, a word that has the same meaning, whose character is always separation. So we're back to a much closer form of the prayer that has been in the prayer books from the beginning. Again, you can see the nature of the struggle. I think that the thing is, as you do this with the people, if you give them a kind of simple introduction to what's going on. And again, particularly in the renewed nation, towards some of the college bishops and media produced one that was nearer to the original form. But the fact is that the form that was in the 1979 prayer book as prayer A was so deeply embedded that the bishops chose to embrace that form of the law of prayer rather than the one that had been used for a short time. If people understand that's the reason for the change, I think they'll be able to embrace the change already. Okay, if we look at that, in the post-communion prayer, and now Father sent this out since 1979, gave things to the world to do the work here. Everybody trips over it. we're back to, and now Father sent us out to do the work that they must do. Because, of course, the sending out is sending out to the world. So that's, again, it's just one of those things that people trip over. It was hard to get, even still, circumstances were false. Trip over that line, the relation of that in the world will actually. I think in each diocese, and certainly Pittsburgh has a form that has been in use for some while, which recommends what the deacon would say. If the bishop has put that forward, then this can be adjusted to that. What I expect is going to happen is, again, because we have this capacity with the website, that somebody will produce a full form for a deacon presiding at Eucharist, and it'll get put up there and be useful for a lot of dioceses. But again, for the prayer book itself, the issue is how to produce what would be ordinary, recognizing that in some dioceses, deacons would be permitted to carry the sacrament. Not so much anymore, but there's still some that. All of the feedback was, even with the very first time that it was produced, was that it had been restored. Because it wasn't in 79. Again, there was a debate about was this too literal? That our simple bodies may clean like the body, and our souls washed with the most precious blood. That was pretty wild language. The issue is it's actually in all the prayer books up until 79. So there was no deep sentiment for the 79 anonymous form. Because, as I say, this prayer of all the prayers is the one that's most deeply rooted in people. There were a lot of folks right off the bat who said, what 79 did to it was unacceptable. It needs to be restored to how I always prayed. So that's how the Muslims helped out. In the additional directions, which apply to both services, just take a quick look there, and then I think we're pretty nearly done. This prayer book is the first prayer book to say in the form way that the rubrics indicating standard and dealing imply a table. Yeah, just the same. There are a lot of folks in our churches who may not be able to stand for a long time or heal. And there are a lot of situations where that's difficult. Clear that the Lord be with you, and also you may be used in place with your spirit. One is the teaching related and with your spirit. There remains debate about why did we go back to that move your spirit. And at the time this was adopted, it was also the time that the Catholic Church promulgated its responses, its revised responses, you know, 30 years after the International Consultation on English Texts. And they went back to the ministry. What it turns out is that across the early church, there was a very peculiar way in which Christians greeted each other. And it was in with their spirit. It's true both in Greek and in Latin. And the notion was that the greeting was to be as spirit that had been given you in baptism. That's what that is. There is a very peculiar reading. When it's how it came in the Latin Ecclesiastical spiritual tool, it's how it existed in the rites up until the Second Vatican Council. Interestingly enough, and with your spirit was translated in French and German and the other languages in modern, still and with your spirit. The only language in which and also the Hebrew came into use was English. So again, this is one of their things where continuity and clarity, somehow clarity is because they, and also the view is seems clear. Yet the issue in the tradition is that also the view is not what the church was saying originally. The church was saying, and there's the spirit that's been given to you. The Lord be with you. And with the spirit that's been given. This is a post-baptism greeting. So you could, what we give permission for is in those congregations where it's important to say it also with you, you can. Okay, the additional directions and so the great thing about movements is you don't have to ask permission. You do just have to wonder when he's coming, oh, we use the contemporary form of that greeting mission. Penitential order, an outline of penitential orders here. Again, Anglicans are the only folks in military traditions who don't have the confessional font. Grammar is very particular about putting the confession after the preaching. So you can preach for repentance and conversion. But the rest of the church is, if you go to the Lutheran liturgy or Catholic liturgy, you're going to find a confession of time. You're going to find a penitential of time, which is not going to make sense. But again, it's not part of the Anglican way of understanding. Again, it's not really the English Reformation to deal with. And there's still some real validity to the wording. For the first time, this permission is given again to use the Athanasian Creed. Again, permission is given. The prayers of the people, again, here's an outline for congregations that write their own prayers to the people, and any number of congregations do that just include these things. But interestingly enough, the confession. For morning prayer or either Eucharistic text may be substituted for any other. Again, in certain circumstances, it may be that the form of confession from the daily office is more familiar to the people. Again, if you have a prayer book Christian who's in the hospital and near death and they want to confess, they may want to be better able to say from memory morning prayer confession than they can the Eucharistic confession. So it's just to say that all of these accomplish the same purpose and you have this freedom. The issues are all using the same language. There are three ways in which this can be done. But there's these three ways of saying it, not an infinite number of ways. But they're interchangeable. You see there's permission given for the first time, bread and wine are placed on the holy table by the deacon, solemn, or other appointed person, simply the recognition that in some congregations somebody else was putting, said that they were giving permission for it. Sometimes giving permission is just recognizing what's already being done and deciding how to fight it. the deacons make an issue of this with the assumption is that the deacon's going to do it. If there's not a deacon there, maybe somebody else is going to do it. And, again, the provision for the anamnesis to be formally memorial activation. There is a provision in the prayer for access this matter. Here's a very important thing. How do you deal with running out of bread and wine? And the decision here is to have a standard way to consecrate more elements that applies in any Eucharistic service. And it's easily committed to memory. Hear us, O Heavenly Father, and the Word of the Holy Spirit. Bless and sanctify this bread, and may also be the sacrament of the precious body of your Son Jesus Christ, our Lord, who took bread and said, "This is my body." It has a call on the Holy Spirit and the central word of institution. And it's again changed for the one, but you don't have to fish within the Eucharistic rite that you're in for the way to do it. Here's the way to do it, and I, again, I need strong courage of the bishops to memorize this, and then whatever rites you're in, this is the way that your church function to do this. The direction about what to do with extra consecrated and wine, the assumption is bread will be and wine will be preserved if it's going to be necessary for future reception. If it's not set aside, the bread is consumed. The wine may be consumed or river be poured upon the untrodden ground. It's a way to say this has to be dealt with especially. And it's not just for down the sink. The sink is one thing, but in so many of our circumstances, with folks not in church buildings, how do you deal rather than deal with this? And then finally, we get the whole ordering of Holy Communion according to the prayer of 1662. And that entire list is there. And then concerning discipline, Holy Communion, the language has been cleaned up somewhat to make it clear what's necessary if there are two parties who are causing scandal by their enmity, and what if one repents of it, and how do you deal with it. There's also a shift here which says that the old provision was that this has to be reported within 14 days. What this says is, if you're going to excommunicate somebody, you need to report it to the bishop as fast as you can, because you can be relatively short and angry with the bishop from the touch of him, and it would be better if you had your ally on your side. I just say. again, those are the principal things that have been altered. You also have here a copy of the folders of copies 19 of that kind of four-part just so you can look at it. Questions, comments that would be helpful for before we watch this out on the quiz. So I think we can build a question. Thank you for your attendance and